want to talk about today, brethren, is kind of, maybe I'll start by sharing some of what's happening in the Rosinko family lately. There was a movie that I saw when I was 7 years old, which was a pretty cool movie. That was 1977 was 37 years ago. I can still do math as an engineer without my calculator. And it was called Star Wars. And I can't believe that my kids, little Michael, is into Star Wars. I don't know if you knew that. If you knew that, who hasn't seen Star Wars? Everybody's seen it. I mean, it was a big movie, right? It changed the culture of movies. And I just can't believe that it's still popular as it is today. Now, I don't know what your thoughts of or with me letting my kids watch Star Wars, because it is fantasy, and, you know, it's aliens and all this other stuff, but I don't mind it because I think there's some interesting themes in Star Wars. Good versus evil, the dark side of the Force, which is tempting, and once you start down that pathway based on your internal lusts and selfishness, it's very difficult to get off that pathway, right? And the good side of the Force is all about selflessness and being good, and it's the good side. So I think there's some good messages there. But I bring that up because, you know, the fact is, brethren, that's all fantasy. It's not real. It's not real, is it? I think of those James Bond movies where you have Spectre. Spectre is the bad guy. It's an evil organization that's behind all of the big crime in the world. Now, nobody here believes that there's any evil organization behind anything going on in the world, is there? Maybe this group does believe it. You know, I was thinking, I go out in the morning every morning. I don't know why lately, the last few years, I'm waking up at 5:30 every morning. Maybe it's something that's going to happen to me as I get older. My dad gets up at 2 a.m. So I guess that's what's coming. So I grab my coffee and I go sit on the back porch. And it's beautiful. I mean, the sun's shining. Things are pretty good. I have my health. I know, you know, for now, I know things change. But overall, things are pretty good. I'm not hungry. I have a pretty good place to live in. You know, it's hard for me to really get my mind around some of what the Bible shares with us beyond the physical. Now, just share with, you know, for me, it seems easier for me personally to connect with the reality of God. Because I have the Bible, I have evidence, I pray, I spend time talking to God, so God seems more real to me. But this concept of this demonic realm, Satan the devil, and all these demons, are they really real? I mean, really? Now, most people in the world, I don't know if they believe in the devil, but when you think of the devil, you think of a cartoon, you think of a character. I mean, when it comes right down to it, is Satan and the demons really real? Is there some powerful being surrounding this church right now, today, that we should be aware of? I don't know, things look pretty good. Most people would think that if you believe in the devil, you're probably not really into science or into logical thinking. So I don't know. What's the truth? You start looking at some of the evidence, some of the things that Bill just went through, and you see the craziness and the irrationality, the lack of reason and logic in the world. You see some of this confusion out there, and you start looking at some of these examples, and you say, how do I explain this craziness? How do you explain people that seem to be scientific and smart seriously considering pedophilia as a right lifestyle. I mean, give me a break. How do you explain these things? Thank God that you find that repulsive. I guess there are people that don't. It's kind of crazy to think about. You start listing other examples of what we see in the world in terms of the violence, and you look beyond the United States. Bill mentioned that it's hard for us sometimes to get out of the United States because we're so pampered in this country. But you start thinking about the majority of the people in the world are in poverty. The majority of the people in the world have to think about where they're going to get their food the next day. There's disease. The world in general isn't that great of a place for most of us. I mean, we have tremendous blessings here. So you start to think about these other things and you say, well, maybe there is something to this evil force behind the confusion and madness in the world. So what I want to talk about today is going through some scriptures and talk about what the Bible reveals to us about Satan, demons, and angels. Just take a little bit of time and go through some of that. I thought, for me, I don't know about you, but for me it's a very interesting topic because I remember Garner Ted Armstrong or someone said one time in a sermon, imagine, so I have glasses, if you had glasses and my buddies in the Marines used to call it the spirit, you know, spirit goggles. They were actually referring to a few alcoholic beverages. But the idea is you take these goggles, these glasses, and if you could imagine putting these glasses on, it's almost like 3D glasses, and all of a sudden you can see spirit. You wonder what kind of spiritual beings are flying around us. If you could see them. I want to share a couple scriptures to give you some insight into that. So let's start by asking the question, so what is an angel? I think that's a good place to start. What is an angel? So let's turn over to Psalm. Actually, I'm going to read Psalm and then go ahead. You can turn to Hebrews chapter 1. We're going to go there next. But in Psalms, I think it's important to understand what man is if you ask the question, what is an angel? Psalm chapter 8, verse 4. It says, what is man that thou art mindful of him, talking to God? Who are we, the son of man, that you visitest him? For you have made him a little lower than the angels, and has covered him with glory and honor. Now, the opposite side of that is, what is an angel? Well, an angel is made just a little higher than human beings. Now, God says he's way above us. So that gives you an idea that angels aren't way above us. The scripture says angels are just a little bit higher than us right now. It's kind of an interesting concept. They are higher than us. They do have more power than us. They can move through these dimensions that we can't. We're stuck in three dimensions. But they're a little higher than us. Now over here in Hebrews chapter 1, let's go and read that. And referring back to Psalms here, this section, it says, God... In verse 1, God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, which is basically telling us how he continues to speak to his people through his word. It says, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the world. So another scripture clearly showing that Jesus the Christ was the creator that made everything. Before he became a man. Verse 3, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down in the right hand of the majesty on high. Now, it's amazing. There's a whole Bible right in there, that verse 3. Incredible how much is said there, what Jesus did. Verse 4, being made so much better than the angels as he has by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. So again, referring that Jesus was made so much better than the angels. For unto which of the angels said he at any time, you are my son, this day I have begotten you. And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. And again, when he brings in the first begotten into the world, he says, and let all the angels of God worship him. And the angels, he says, who makes his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire. In other words, what this is showing is that Jesus Christ is way above the angels, and the angels are meant to minister to the sons of God, those that are in God's family. It says in later on in Hebrews that we are to judge angels when we're born into God's family. So we're a little lower than angels. Angels are a little higher than us, but we, when we're born into God's family, as Jesus Christ has now paved the way, will be much higher than angels. So I just want to establish that first in terms of what is an angel. An angel is a spirit being a little higher than us that will not be born into God's family as a family member of God. That's what Hebrews tells us. We will. Colossians chapter 1, verse 16 says that angels were created beings. In Mark chapter 9, verse 17, we learn that there are different kinds of angels. Let's turn over there, Mark chapter 9, verse 17, because this is a very interesting story to give you some insight into different types of angels. Now, this is a specific type of angel we're going to talk about. I'm going to call this an angel because really that's what it is. It's a spirit being that's an angel, a certain type of angel. But Mark chapter 9, let's turn over there. Because here Jesus is dealing with this angel. Mark chapter 9, verse 17. And one of the multitude answered and said, Master, speaking to Jesus, I have brought unto you my son, which has a dumb spirit. So the son had some sort of affliction. And wheresoever he taketh him, he tears him. So this person thought that his son was demon-possessed or had some sort of spirit in him that was causing him to be afflicted. And the father was describing a sign saying that this being is tearing at him, and he foams, and he gnashes with his teeth and pines away. And I spake to the disciples. I went to your disciples, Jesus, that they should cast out this angel that was afflicting him. And they could not. And then drop down in verse 23. And Jesus said unto him, if you can believe, all things are possible to him that believes. And straightway the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe. Help you my unbelief. And we see that Jesus was moved with this faith. And when Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the foul spirit, saying unto him, thou dumb and deaf spirit. So now we see that there are angels that are referred to as a dumb and deaf spirit, a certain type of spirit, a certain type of angel. So Jesus says, thou dumb and deaf spirit, I charge you, come out of him and enter no more into him. And this spirit, think of the glasses, if you could put those glasses on and you can see this happening, this spirit being cried and rent him sore and came out of him. And he was as one dead. So this boy fell down like he was dead. And so much that many said, he is dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up. And the boy arose. And when he was come into the house, his disciples asked him privately, why could not we cast out this demon? And Jesus said unto them, this particular kind of angel can come forth by nothing but by prayer and fasting. So that tells me that there are many different kinds of angels. We'll get a little bit more into that as we go. You can read in the Old Testament. If you want to do a study, you can go to Knave's Topical Bible or a concordance, and you'll see that angels are referred to as cherubims. So those are certain types of angels. Seraphims, they're described with wings and different types of faces, and you can go through and I'll let you study that on your own, but it'll describe what angels will look like. So there are many different types of angels. Now, there are many references of angels throughout the Bible. What do angels do? God said that they're to minister, to help God carry out his plan. So you'll see examples of angels bringing news to people, bringing revelation to the prophets, making announcements, providing protection to people. Jesus tells us that our children, if you're in God's church, our children have angels. Angels are going to grab the false prophet and pick him up and throw him into the lake of fire. Angels are going to help Jesus to bring about the events that are going to take place before he returns. Angels ministered to Jesus after he was tempted. So you see, angels have many different functions. Abraham saw an angel. An angel went to Lot. The Hagar, Moses, Gideon, Joseph. And you can read many more examples of when Jesus had interactions with demons, when angels interacted with God's people throughout the Bible. Now the question is, are angels real? Well, I would just challenge you, do you believe your Bible? Have you proven that this is the Word of God? Do you believe Jesus, your Savior? So just that alone for me, the evidence of God's Word and the fact that all these interactions aren't just made up stories, that there are eyewitnesses of these events, that tells me that angels and these foul angels that Jesus described are actually real. Now, I guess it takes faith because I don't know how many of you have actually seen an angel. I personally have not seen an angel, at least that I was aware of. And Paul tells us that sometimes we probably have maybe been around or interacted with an angel, but we weren't aware of it, because angels can make themselves look like human beings. But some of the examples of like when the angel appeared to Daniel and some of the prophets where they were terrified, maybe seeing them the way that, you know, in their spiritual form, I haven't seen them. So it takes some faith and some study, and you have to believe the Word of God. So that said, I want to shift gears now and talk about these types of angels called demons. Are demons real? We read a couple examples. You can read in Mark chapter 1, verse 34, how Jesus, it says, and he healed many that were sick of diverse diseases, and Jesus cast out many devils, many demons, and suffered not the devils to speak because they knew him. So not only did he cast them out, but he shut their mouths because Jesus didn't want them to tell the people who Jesus was before it was time. Luke chapter 4 talks about many people bringing people to Jesus to cast out demons. Turn with me to Mark chapter 5. I want to read another example here. Mark chapter 5. In verse 1, and they came over unto the other side of the sea, this is Mark chapter 5, verse 1, in the country of Gadarenes, and when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. So another example of a man that was afflicted by one of these spirit beings, who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no man could bind him. No, not with chains. So this man had super strength. Even with chains, he was breaking the chains. Because that he had been often bound with fetters and chains, they tried to chain him up, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, so he just ripped them apart. And the fetters broken in pieces, neither could any man tame him. So here's just picture this man that was just this wild man. And always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. But when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshipped him. Now that's interesting. and cried with a loud voice and said, "What have I to do with you, Jesus?" So this demon knew who Jesus was. And I don't know about you, but I find it very curious that this demon went and worshiped Jesus. I always thought demons were the adversary and would never worship Jesus. So I don't know. There's a lot that I don't still get about demons and Jesus and God. I think about in Job when Satan still has access to the throne of God, apparently, when he went and talked to God. He said, "Oh yeah, you think Job is so good? Take off that hedge. Let me at him." So, you know, there's still things that I don't get, so I think it's just very interesting. Maybe requires more study there. But this demon went up to Jesus and worshipped him and said, "What have I to do with you, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I adjure you by God that thou torment me not." So this demon respected Jesus and apparently didn't want Jesus to mess with him. And he asked him, "What is your name?" Jesus is speaking to one of these spirits. And he answered, saying, "My name is Legion, for we are many." Now that, I don't know if that gives you the creeps. Gives me the creeps. That there could be many demons inside of this person. And that this demon was smart enough and aware enough to know that he didn't want to mess with Jesus. And he besought him much that he would not send them away out of the country. Now there was there nigh unto the mountains a great herd of swine feeding, and all the devils besought him, saying, "Send us in." So in other words, this demon must have known that Jesus was going to get rid of them out of this man's body. So then they started negotiating with Jesus. They said, "Well, at least let us go into those swine." So apparently these demons didn't like not being in some sort of body. I don't know. And forthwith Jesus gave them leave. Another interesting thing to learn from this about the power that Jesus had. Jesus gave them leave. Said, "Okay, you can go into the swine." And the unclean spirits went out and entered into the swine, and the herd ran violently down a steep place into the sea. They were about 2,000, so there was about two, I guess that indicates that there was about 2,000 demons in this person. And then they drove the swine down and into the sea, and they were choked or they drowned. Very interesting story about the nature of demons. Now, if I believe this word, then that tells me that these are real beings that we need to be aware of. There's another example in Acts chapter 19 of a man with superhuman strength from a demon. You can read it in 19, verse 13 through 16. You'll read about how the disciples tried to cast this demon out, and the demon ended up beating him up. You won't go there, but it's a good read to show some of the power that these demons have. These demons know who God is. So James chapter 2, verse 19 says, "Thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble." So I look at these scriptures, brethren, and it helps me to realize, just bring to my attention, the forefront of my mind, that these are real beings. That there are powers out there. There is the dark side of the force that we have to deal with out in this world. And it's important for us not to get too comfortable. I think every once in a while, take a step back and realize that there are these powerful beings out there that want to harm us. Now, what about Satan? Let's turn over to Isaiah chapter 14, because Satan is a very special type of angel. And I want to spend a little bit of time talking about Satan. Isaiah chapter 14. Isaiah 14, we'll start in verse 12 here. This is speaking of a being called Lucifer. And if you've been studying God's word, you'll know that Lucifer was the name of Satan before he committed his sin. But it says here in Isaiah verse 14, verse 12, or chapter 14, verse 12, talking about Lucifer, "How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer?" So here we see that the Bible's telling us that Lucifer fell from heaven. He's called the son of the morning. The morning is the sun rising, the brightness, light. "How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations?" So here's Lucifer, and we're going to read in Ezekiel that Lucifer was this very beautiful, wise being that had a special place in God's government. And this is asking, "How were you fallen down?" It says, "For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven." So this is speaking of the sin that Lucifer committed. He said in his heart, "I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High." Now, I've heard a number of different explanations for what was going on in Lucifer's mind here. The prevailing one is that Lucifer was trying to overthrow God. Now, if I just completely ignore things that I've heard in the past, and I read this, I see that he just wanted to be like God. It says in verse 14, "I will be like the Most High." It says that he would ascend above the stars of God, which are the angels, not above God. So, just Dave's opinion, I look at this and saying that Lucifer wanted to be in God's family the way we are destined to be in God's family. Something to consider. And I guess that would make sense to me, being so wise, that he just got jealous. I would imagine that he learned about God's plan for humankind, that we created lower than the angels were going to be brought through a process and born into God's family, and then be put in charge of the angels, even in charge of Lucifer, to judge him. I think it's just interesting to think about how that would make Lucifer feel, and the jealousy that could come from that. So just the interesting things about Satan here, what was going through his mind. But he says here in Isaiah 14 that he, at some point, for whatever reason, decided that he was going to ascend above the other angels and become like God. Luke chapter 10 describes of Jesus seeing Satan falling from heaven like lightning. Now turn with me over to Ezekiel, because I want to read a little bit more about this being called Lucifer and what was going through Lucifer's mind, what he was like before he committed that sin and what he's like afterwards. Ezekiel chapter 28. Now this is speaking of a prophecy with the king of Tyre, but shifts gears speaking about the king of Tyre, and clearly as you get into this you realize that, or of Tyrus, I'm sorry, the king of Tyrus, that the context is no longer speaking of the king of Tyrus because of some of the references, but more speaking about Satan, the devil. Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 12. "Son of man, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus, and say unto him, Thus says the Lord God." Now this is where you start to realize that this is now referring to Lucifer or Satan. "Thou sealest up the sum, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty." Reminds me of in 2 Corinthians when Paul said, "Isn't Satan transformed into an angel of light?" So Satan isn't this cartoon with a red face and horns. Whatever Satan looks like, he looks beautiful and enticing. "Thou hast been in Eden." Okay, so I'm only aware of four beings that were in Eden: Adam, Eve, God, and Satan. So this kind of tells me again that we're speaking about one of those four beings, and I don't think this is speaking about Adam or Eve or God. So this tells me this is speaking of Satan the devil. So thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering, and I picture a king with this robe and all these precious stones over the robe. So that tells me that there was glory and honor given to this being. Every precious stone was your covering, the sardius, the topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, sapphire, emerald, carbuncle, the gold. I don't know what a carbuncle is, but I guess it was probably pretty. The workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes was prepared in you the day that thou was created. So this being was created beautiful. It had a special place of honor and status in God's spiritual realm. We can continue to read. You'll see that this was a covering cherub. It had a special place covering even the throne of God. It says in verse 20, 15, thou wast perfect in your ways. I'm sorry, I skipped verse 14. It says, thou art the anointed cherub that covers. Again, anointed being separated, special privilege, special place in God's kingdom that covers the throne of God. And I have set you so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of God, or the holy kingdom of God. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou was perfect in your ways from the day that you were created until iniquity was found in you, or lawlessness was found in you. So until the time when this being had this jealousy or this sin, had a special place and was beautiful and perfect. It says, by thy multitude of thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of you with violence. So after the sin, violence overtook this being. And thou hast sinned. Therefore, I will cast you as profane out of the mountain of God. And I will destroy you, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. Thine heart was lifted up because of your beauty, and thou hast corrupted your wisdom by reason of thy brightness. In other words, vanity got the best of this being. I will cast you to the ground. I will lay you before kings, that they may behold you. Thou hast defiled thy sanctuaries by thy multitude of thine iniquities, by the iniquity of thy traffic. Therefore will I bring forth a fire from the midst of you. It shall devour you, and I will bring you to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all them that behold you. And they that know you among the people shall be astonished at you, that thou shalt be a terror, and never shall you be any more. Very interesting scripture describing the nature of Lucifer and then Satan after he committed his sin. Just turn with me over here to Isaiah now, chapter 45, because another insight into what happened during this rebellion, this sin of Satan the devil. And I think it's important as it starts to give us some insight into how there became these foul spirits, demons, versus angels. Isaiah chapter 45, verse 18. For thus says the Lord that created the heavens, God himself that formed the earth and made it, he has established it and created it not in vain. Now this word vain is a Hebrew word called tohu, which means confusion, waste, destruction. So I want to go here because this scripture tells us very plainly that God did not create the earth in waste or confusion or destruction. So just keep that in mind. Now turn back with me to Genesis chapter 1. Verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was or became tohu. That's what it means. Without form, void, darkness, confusion. So we see in Isaiah that God did not create the earth tohu, but in Genesis, somehow the earth became tohu, or confusion, or waste, or destroyed. You continue on to see how the earth at that point in time was just black darkness, no land, no life, just water. So how did the earth get that way? Now turn with me to Revelation chapter 12. Revelation chapter 12, because I mentioned at the beginning of this message about a movie from 1977, and this is where you start to see the real battle, the real Star Wars. Revelation chapter 12, verse 7. Here it tells us through God's word, it's revealed to us that there was a war in heaven. There was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels, so here's one of these archangels and his angels, fought against the dragon, referring to Satan. And the dragon fought and his angels. So the Bible tells us that at some point in history, there was a war in heaven between these spiritual beings. And it would be, I think, connecting the dots, when Satan rebelled, it makes sense that that's when that war happened. But the dragon prevailed not, it says, and prevailed not, neither was their place found any more in heaven. And that great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceives the whole world. Again, explaining some of this craziness in the world. Now we start to get some insight that Satan deceives the world. But he was cast out into where? The earth. Satan, because of this galactic battle, the real Star Wars lost that battle and was cast down to the earth. And his angels were cast out with him. Now, in Revelation chapter 12, verse 3, it says a third part of the angels were cast out with him. And in verse 5, or chapter 5 of Revelation, it talks about 10,000 times 10,000 angels at God's throne. So now, after a third of the angels were cast down to the ground, Revelation chapter 5 talks about the angels that are still up at God's throne. It says there's 10,000 times 10,000. Now the mathematician here said, okay, let's multiply that out. Now I don't know if it's exactly 10,000 times 10,000 angels, but I take it as at least that much. So 10,000 times 10,000 is 100 million angels. So if that's two-thirds that are left in heaven, one-third is 50 million. So now I say there's at least 100 million angels in heaven and 50 million demons that came down with Satan to the earth. So let's put our glasses back on. There's 50 million of these demonic beings that are influencing this earth. Now there's 7.2 billion in the people, so that would mean that there are 72 people for every angel in heaven and 144 people for every demon. Now, if you go into a train station, you're easily within a couple hundred people. And it'd be easy for me to walk around and pick some people out in 140-some people and start to pick on them. So for every 144 people in the earth, there's at least one demon that can have at them. Now, you might say, but all the demons aren't focused on all the people, and I bet that's right. So there's only 322 million people in the United States, so if the demons decided, let's just focus on the United States, there would be 3.2 angels per citizen, or 3.4 people per angel, or 6 people per demon. Now the demons have a little bit better number. There could be a demon for 6 people. Then you might say, well, let's just focus on God's church. So I looked it up. I couldn't get a number for the God, you know, Church of God, but I said, okay, there's Seventh-day Adventists, people that at least keep the Sabbath. There's 17 million of them. So if the demons wanted to focus just on those 17 million, that would be 3 demons per person. So, if you're the bright light in a world of darkness, and demons wanted to focus their attention on you because you're closest to the truth, you're a lot less than 17 million. Think of how many demons could be trying every day to knock you off that path. I want to go over to Daniel chapter 9 because I think this is a really amazing story. I just want to spend a little bit more time here and then we'll start to wrap it up. Daniel chapter 9 verse 21. I think this is a fascinating story to understand what's happening in the spiritual realm with the interaction between angels and demons, things that we're completely oblivious to. Daniel chapter 9 verse 21. An angel is going to come and talk to Daniel. So here it says in verse 21 of chapter 9 of Daniel, "Yea, while I was speaking in prayer, even the man Gabriel," so here Gabriel the archangel, "whom I had seen in the vision at the beginning," so Daniel must have seen a vision and Gabriel must have spoke to him, "being caused to fly swiftly, touched me about the time of the evening oblation." So here Gabriel's coming to interact with Daniel. "And he informed me and talked with me and said, O Daniel, I am now come forth to give you skill and understanding." Now, turn over to Daniel chapter 10 because there's more to this story here. So that just kind of sets the stage that here Gabriel came to instruct Daniel. Now, Daniel chapter 10, verse 10. And Gabriel's confessing something to Daniel here. Gabriel says, "And behold," or Daniel says, "and behold, a hand touched me, which set me upon my knees and upon the palms of my hand." So this being grabbed Daniel and put him on his knees. Verse 11, "And he said unto me, O Daniel, a man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak unto you, and stand upright, for unto you am I now sent. And when he had spoken this word unto me, I stood trembling." So Daniel must have been able to see Gabriel, not just as a vision of a human, but as the angel Gabriel. Verse 12, "Then said he unto me, Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that you did set your heart to understand and to chasten yourself before your God, thy words were heard." So very interesting insight that when you start to obey God, God starts to hear you. Very interesting. Tells Daniel that when he started to obey God, that God heard his words. And Gabriel said, "And I come for thy words." So Gabriel's telling Daniel, I'm coming to you. I wanted to come and tell you this. He says, "But the prince of the kingdom of Persia," the prince of the kingdom of Persia. Now, I guess this could have been a physical man, the prince of the kingdom of Persia, but I can't imagine how a physical man could keep Gabriel, an angel, a spirit being, from Daniel. So I interpret this that there is a demonic being that has the position in Satan's organizational structure as the prince of Persia. So here's a demon who's in charge of Persia. Now I said that there's only one demon, if that's only 150 million demons, one for every 144 people. But demons are pretty smart, and Satan's pretty smart, so he doesn't have to influence every person individually. What if there's a prince, a demon, who's the prince of the United States? How about a demon who's the prince of the American Psychiatric Administration? Think of the havoc that demon could have by getting a couple articles published. You think of the judges and common law. How about a demon who's in charge of the Supreme Court of the United States? That demon's sole purpose is to try to influence and affect the Supreme Court. See, a couple strategically positioned demons in authority can have a major, major impact on the culture and the craziness in this world. That's a very interesting insight that I see here in this story, that there was a demon that was actually preventing Gabriel from getting to Daniel, some wrestling or match. And Gabriel was confessing to Daniel that this prince of Persia was keeping him from him. Something interesting to think about. So how do demons work? Well, we see that they can possess people. In Acts, in Revelation chapter 16, verse 14, it says that demons can perform miracles. So witchcraft, levitation, can perform these great miracles to deceive people. You start to think of what could happen and how a demon can cause confusion. You think of peer pressure, entertainment. You see some of the things that are going on in our news. How about a prince of Fox News? A demon that's trying to make sure that certain things make it into the LA Times, into our media. Music, philosophy, politics. A demon that's in charge of the Department of Education. Now, Satan the devil's mission is to prove to God that human beings are not worthy to be born into his family. And his tactics, he's a shrewd tactician. He was summed up to have all wisdom. Satan's pretty smart. He's not going to come at us as a full frontal assault. He disguises himself as an angel of light. He's enticing. He looks good. Some of these sitcoms are funny. I watch some of these sitcoms and I'm starting to think, I like that gay guy on that show. He's a pretty funny guy. Now, as Christians, we are to love everybody, and I pray for everybody. We're all sinners. But the behavior is a sin. And you can see how diabolical it is. You make it seem so good and right, and we're just trying to give everybody their rights. Oh, we're all for liberty. Those pedophiles should have a right to be happy. It says, well, I have a right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And if it makes them happy, who am I to judge? You see, Satan wants to remove the standard. He confuses us. He creates confusion. There's no more standard of right and wrong. You start to make sense of how is this world so crazy, and you realize that is the number one proof that Satan and demons really are real, because you can see it. That is a logical explanation for all of the irrational views that are out in the world today. I looked at the number of different religions. You look at Satan's tactic of creating confusion around truth and Christianity. I looked this up. There's over 21,000 Christian denominations. You think Satan is effectively confusing people that want to follow Christ? Not to mention all the other religions, Muslim, Hindu, Buddhism. What's so amazing, and another proof that Satan has power in strategic places, is there's only 2% of the world that are atheists. But if you look at the news and science and education and universities, it would seem like a lot more than 2%, wouldn't it? Another evidence that Satan is influencing the world. I think, brethren, you could spend a lot of time looking out in the world, looking through the scriptures, and it becomes very clear that there is a powerful, demonic, not just being, but organization of beings that are down here that we are fighting and wrestling with. It talks about in Ephesians that we are wrestling with principalities and powers. So with all that said, so what? What does this mean to us? Let's just turn to a couple of scriptures. Go to Ephesians chapter 5. This is the so what, brother, and this is what it means. What do we do as Christians in light of this? One, I think just being aware helps us to deal with it. Just being aware to help us explain why these things are happening. But Ephesians chapter 5, verse 11, I think it's right up here on the Church of God's banner. Chapter 5, verse 11. For this you know that, I'm sorry, I'm in the wrong scripture. Okay, here it is. Chapter 5, verse 11. For this you know that no whoremonger nor unclean person, I'm reading in verse 5, sorry. Verse 11, Dave. Ephesians 5, verse 11. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. So here, God is telling you through Paul that we are not to have any fellowship with anything that even appears to be demonic. So all of you young people that your friends want to get a Ouija board and you start watching some of these crazy movies about witchcraft, God's telling you, just turn away from that stuff. Don't get involved in it. You're messing with fire. Have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. But all things that are reproved are made manifest by the light, for whatsoever does make manifest is light. I don't think that was a scripture I wanted to go to, but it worked. So we'll stick with it. Turn with me to Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. So instead of focusing on those things, we as Christians, this is where our mind needs to be. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. You see, I think one of Satan's tactics is to get us thinking negatively. Get us thinking about things that we shouldn't think about. When you find that happening, go to Philippians chapter 4 and put your mind on good, wholesome, clean things. James chapter 4 says that if we resist Satan, he will flee from us. Isaiah 59 says that if you stop keeping God's commandments, sin will separate you from him. We need God's Spirit in us to combat Satan. Jesus says if he will never leave you, in Matthew chapter 28, and that his Spirit will give you strength and power. Stay connected in God's Word. Have good habits of prayer and meditation and study. Don't let your mind go to negative places. Keep your mind positive, thinking on good, lovely, pure things. And stay connected with Jesus. Build God's Spirit, strengthen it in you, and he will surround you with angels that will keep all those demons away from you and your family. That's the so what, brethren. Just to be aware that these spirits are real, that they're out there, and as God's people, we need to be motivated, knowing that knowledge, to even more so stay connected to God's Word and stay connected to God and Jesus Christ, because he is your safe harbor. He'll give you the strength to overcome, and he'll protect you from all these wicked spirits and help to keep you on that straight, narrow path toward God's kingdom, where God wants to bring you to be born into his family and someday, brethren, judge the angels.